I'm Dr. Craig Sarver. I'm with the Animal Disease Diagnostic Lab, and this is part of Animal Health. And what we're going to do is take a quick tour of what we do every day at the Diagnostic Lab. We'll start out here. You're walking into the front doors. First, you'll meet our receptionists. We have four different vet techs working at the front desk. When you come in, we'll usually have the owners bring their animals to us. They usually come in here, and we'll get a history from them. They'll fill out information telling us about their animal, and from there we'll get an idea what's going on the farm. So they can sit here, they'll fill out their information, and like I said, they can come to and stay and watch the autopsy. Right now, we have Lauren, who's one of our vet techs. She's unloading a deer, and the nice thing about the crane system we have here, it will hold up to 2 tons, that's 4,000 pounds, and she's able to move those around so that we can take these animals off from the truck or car that they're bringing it in, and then she can bring it in, place it on the tables, and those are surgery tables, they'll hold up to 2 tons, and they'll go up and down just like a surgery table would. They're the same ones that are used at Ohio State in their veterinary hospital. She's just moving it around, probably going to put it in one of the coolers. We have two large coolers, an in cooler and an out cooler, and they'll hold several thousand pounds of animals and stuff. The smaller tables we have here are for smaller animals, for sheep, goats, pigs, and chickens, and the bigger table is for horses and cattle, pigs, and other large animals and stuff. We do once in a while see some other unusual animals. We'll see stuff from the wilds, which are antelope and zebras, giraffes. We've had some rhinoceroses from them, and also from the Columbus Zoo. We get stuff from them all the time too. We've done gorillas, we've done a couple of giraffes from them, and a polar bear, and when SeaWorld was here, we used to get dolphins and sea lions and porpoises, and we were always worried about having Shamu come down, but thank God SeaWorld closed before he passed away. So once we're done, we'll collect tissues and stuff. Lauren, like I said, is our vet tech. She'll help collect tissues. There's refrigerators in the wall next, clear over on the far side, and we'll put those tissues in, and the different sections of the lab will come and pick it up, and we'll run through those different sections as we go. Okay, so we'll head back down where a lot of the work's done. And this is the pathology suite. This is where we do a lot of the slides and stuff. I'll introduce you to Dr. Radebush. This is Dr. Alice Radebush. She's one of the pathologists, and she's looking at slides and stuff, and I'll show you a couple of slides here. CWD. Okay. And we'll show you a couple. What I spend a lot of my day doing is looking at the microscope. We'll see up to about 20,000 slides a year. That includes the chronic wasting disease. And so this actually is called the BSL-3. If we get anything like anthrax or West Nile virus or any really highly contagious agents and stuff, this is where they work on it. This is where actually the Ohio Department of Health does their West Nile testing. We'll go by the room. They did like 500,000 mosquitoes last year looking for West Nile virus. And so they're part of our system here, in which they use our lab space and we use parts of their lab space. Okay, and this is the alkaline hydrolysis. And the alkaline hydrolysis, we use it to get rid of the carcasses and stuff. When we get these big horses and cattle and sheep and pigs and stuff in, they have to go somewhere, and since we don't have an incinerator or you can't render this material, they put it in this giant metal vat, and then they'll pump in sodium hydroxide, and then we have a steam generator to generate steam, so it's up, generates it up to 300 degrees, and then the tissues and stuff are all dissolved away, and all that's left is bone. So if you have about, there's about 7,000 pounds of tissues in here, and there's about 1,000 pounds of bone left. And that bone is not, it's not considered sterile, but it's considered non-infectious. And so it can go to a dump or out to a landfill and stuff like that. So there's no DNA and RNA left. It kills the prion. We have rabies cases that go in here, all types of viruses, salmonella. So bacteria, viruses, and these prions are all destroyed by this method. And that's why the state of Ohio got this machine back when Mad Cow, back in 2005, I think was. And since it's been running, we've probably done nearly 2 million pounds of tissues and stuff. All right, this is histology. With histology, what we do is take the tissues from the animals and make them into slides so that we can look at them under the microscope to make a diagnosis. And like I was mentioned, we do anywhere between 15 to 20,000 slides a year. A lot of these are chronic wasting disease slides. It's a immunohistochemistry in which you just saw back in my office and stuff, that red stain that you were seeing. That to light up, we'll show you how that process is and where it takes place here. And that's in this department here. We have one histotech at this time, and he's processing all these tissues and stuff. So, and we'll start here. These are just tissues that we've gotten in the last week. There's over 100 of different, these are all chronic wasting disease. These are brains and lymph nodes from deer. And these are our necropsy cases in which we do autopsies. And so these are the tissues and stuff that we collect. And there's also biopsies in here, which veterinarians will send us biopsies when it's just like you going in and getting a lump or a bump removed off from you. Same way with your dog and cat, they come in here and they'll be processed. And then same way here, these are chronic wasting diseases that are getting ready to be put on. And these are the slides and stuff, they'll make them into slides and stuff there too. And this is Scott Fox, he's our histologist. He's right now, he's cutting some slides and stuff, and we'll, what he does is, these are a specialized knife, and he's working on some tissues right now. That's the brain stem, and those are two lymph nodes that they'll collect for the chronic wasting disease. So that's the knife that will slice the tissues and stuff, and that slices it between 3 to 5 microns. So 3 to 5 microns is thinner than your hair, and this is a section of bone. You can actually see almost completely through it at that thinness. And what we do is then we'll put it in this automatic stainer, and it will colorize it to the different colors, the blues, the yellows, greens. He'll do a couple hundred slides a day, and then those slides are then put through the processor, colorized. They have a cover slipped, and then they're brought up to the pathologist to read.
Hi, my name is Melanie Prerit, and I am a microbiology supervisor at the Animal Disease Diagnostic Lab at the Ohio Department of Agriculture. I'm going to give you a tour of our lab facilities today and show you some of the tests and the people that work here every day. This is our central receiving area. This is the hub of the lab. All samples that come in, whether through USPS, FedEx, UPS, or private courier or drop-off, have to come through this facility and in this lab first. The ADDL processes more than 400,000 samples a year in many different lab sections. For example, we will receive hundreds, sometimes thousands of serology tubes every single day, Monday through Friday. We do testing for things like Coggins disease in horses, bovine viral diarrhea disease in cattle, and Brucella canis in dogs. You saw our necropsy floor earlier. Whenever a pathologist has samples that they want to test for viruses or bacteria, they'll put them in this two-way refrigerator, and then the lab analysts will come pick them up for testing. This is our main hallway in the lab. It hosts most of our bacteriology lab section. We also have several supervisor offices here.
Hi, I'm Dominika Jurkovic. I'm a laboratory scientist 3 in the bacteriology section at ADDL. We are in one of the bacteria rooms. This is the sensitizer room. And what we do in here is test any significant organisms we have found from our samples for antibiotic resistance. So antibiotic resistance is a big problem for humans and animals. And this is the machinery that we use to test our samples. So in a nutshell, we have a bacterial isolate on a petri dish. We plate it on this plate that has a series of antibiotics in different dilutions. And we're just looking for whether or not the bacteria is resistant, which means you can't use an antibiotic, or if the bacteria is sensitive, which means the vet could use an antibiotic. So that is just one thing that we do, and we'll continue our tour down the rest of the bacteria hallway. Media prep, where we make our media. Yoni's lab. Egg testing room. And then this is the main bacteria lab. As you see, we have several hoods, so we could be doing a lot of different testing at once. Here we're growing some isolates on blood auger to QC them before we give them to the whole genome sequencing lab. And in here is the main bacteria section. So we have a couple of different things happening right now. We have salmonella tubes out for plating. These samples start as gauze pads, which are environmental samples that we look to test for Salmonella enteritidis, and that is a human pathogen. And so we want to make sure all the eggs that all of you eat don't have Salmonella in them. So this is kind of how we would do that. We'd plate those organisms, and here they would grow on, we have selective augers. There's two of them here. Most of these are negative today. Good news for everyone. But if we were to get a positive, we would then serogroup them, which is just a fancy way of seeing if they kind of have the particular type of Salmonella that we're looking for. And then back here, you'll see a bunch of different medias that we use depending on what type of bacteria we're looking for. So a vet might suspect E. coli, we would use a routine culture. If a vet suspected Salmonella, we would also do a Salmonella culture, and this is actually what a positive Salmonella looks like. So you don't want to see that. But if they have it, we'll find it. And then here we do a lot of the reading, basically looking at a growth on bacteria, a bacterial growth. And we're trying to get a sense of if what we find is significant. This is actually an example of a colony count that we did for a client from looking to see how much bacteria is in their semen samples. Different bacteria like different places to grow in terms of gas and temperature. So this is an anaerobic chamber. If you're looking for Clostridium or other organisms that don't like oxygen, that would be that. If you're looking for organisms that like oxygen, it'd be the walk-in, 37 degrees Celsius. And then we have other couple special ones. We have a CO2 incubator, which would be for those organisms that are in like the respiratory tract. They like CO2. Reduced oxygen, Campylobacter would be one. And then we have a 42 degree for our poultry, because chickens and turkeys tend to be higher body temperature. So we can use that to our advantage when we're trying to get Salmonella out. We also have a lot of fridges and a walk-in cooler. And behind that door is our autoclave where we can sterilize all of our waste. And the crown jewel of Bactea is our MALDI-TOF. MALDI-TOF is really cool technology. It allows us to identify bacteria within 24 hours of culture as long as it's pure. MALDI-TOF basically uses the idea of creating a protein fingerprint. And when you run the software, you will get a fingerprint. This is not a good example, but let's go ahead and run one real quick for you. So it's just a calibration, but it'll give you an idea of what we're looking for. So the laser is going to sort of energize the bacterial cells. The protein's going to come out of the bacterial cells intact thanks to a solvent. And then there's a detector that's going to see how fast all these proteins get from where the sample starts in here to the sensor. And then you get this profile, the spectral fingerprint. From that fingerprint, it's going to compare it to a database of, I think we're about 8,000, 9,000 now. And it can give you, in less than 30 seconds, what your organism identification is. And that's really cool because you can give results to vets a lot faster. And this is also more economical than traditional culture methods that require a plethora of different types of culture media, and you really couldn't get anything started until you had a nice pure culture. So this is really nice because, say, a client submitted a sample today. If I had some clean colonies tomorrow, I could give you, as a client, a preliminary diagnosis. And basically, it's really the target that's in that machine. You're just taking a little toothpick of colony growth, putting it in those circles, and then covering it with an organic solvent for it to run through the machine. And that's kind of in a nutshell what we do in Bactea.
This is our virology section. Within here, we do more than 38,000 tests a year. We have serum and virus neutralization tests, virus isolation, as well as fluorescent antibody testing. Most of our virus isolation and fluorescent antibody testing happens in this room. This is Ashley. She's one of our lab scientists doing semen straws. If you want to take a look in the hood, we receive thousands of semen straws from multiple bull stud companies across the United States to ensure that semen that's being exported to other countries is free of viral infections like bovine viral diarrhea virus, infectious bovine rhinotracheitis, and other pathogens. We also do a lot of testing on cattle serum to make sure that the actual animals are also free of viral pathogen infections before the animals are transported within the state or across state lines or even international travel. I'll show you the inside of an incubator. You might recall from your biology classes that viruses cannot exist on their own. They need a host cell. So we have multiple incubators within the virology section where we cultivate and take care of over 12 different cell lines ready to be inoculated with clinical samples to ensure that they're virus-free. Or if they do have a virus, we can use virus isolation to identify the specific virus pathogen. While this is more of a historic piece of equipment these days, we do have an electron microscope on campus. Electron microscopes are used to identify viruses like rotavirus or coronavirus in clinical samples. In 2013 and 2014, there was a nationwide outbreak of an emerging viral disease called porcine epidemic diarrhea virus. We used electron microscopy to identify it as a coronavirus, and then Dr. Zhang quickly developed a molecular assay to complement the electron microscopy so that we could quickly diagnose PED at different farms across Ohio. We have a couple examples of viruses we've pictured over the years. Parapox is the agent that causes ORF in humans, so it's a zoonotic virus. We also have pictures of different coronaviruses in fecal samples, as well as rotavirus from porcine fecal samples. More than 34,000 molecular assays at the ADDL each year. This is just a small component of our molecular equipment. Most of our equipment is over in the plant health building, but this room is a lot of research and development that happens in here, as well as method validation and method verification studies. We have a Kaya Excel for capillary gel electrophoresis. This is a up and coming technology that's replacing agarose gel electrophoresis that has been performed for decades. This uses virtually no ethidium bromide, a known mutagen. We also have several different kinds of thermal cyclers because as time goes on, new technologies are always being developed. So we have many different thermal cyclers to do method verifications on, and most of our molecular work is done using real-time PCR, so we can, in real time, see if there's amplification of a genome target in a sample. A lot of our porcine same-day testing is real-time PCR, so we look at swine influenza, enteric coronaviruses in pigs, mycoplasmas, to make sure that animals are free of disease before they are moved. If they come up positive, a lot of times the animals stay wherever they are to prevent spread of a pathogen like influenza. The ADDL is really lucky that we have, we're part of several large national networks through FDA and USDA to do something called whole genome sequencing, specifically of foodborne pathogens, and we have several instruments that do that. We have two Illumina MiSeqs and one Illumina iSeq. It took over 10 years to sequence the first human genome. Nowadays, we can sequence whole genomes in a matter of 2 or 3 days, and with bacteria, it can be even less than that. We are ISO 17025 accredited for this method as well. In our serology lab section, we do over 150,000 tests a year. Most of it is on exports. You can go in that room if you want. We do pseudorabies, PRRS, brucellosis testing to ensure that animals are vaccinated or free of a pathogen depending on the test. It's not uncommon for the analysts in the serology section to test thousands of samples every single day. There's a lot of seasonality in our work. So during certain times of the year, we're extremely busy. And during certain times of the year, serology staff have to come work on Saturdays just to keep up with the workload. Hi, Allie.
Hi, Mary.
This is our avian serology room. Even though this is only one room, the two full-time staff that work in here do over 200,000 tests a year, about half of the entire testing workload of our laboratory. Ohio is number 2 in the country for egg-laying hen production. It's a very protected industry in our state, and it's not uncommon for these two analysts to test thousands and thousands of samples each day just in this room alone. A lot of the testing is for avian influenza and paramyxovirus, as well as reovirus and several other avian pathogens. This is one of the serology rooms. This is where most of the leptospira testing is done. Thousands of lepto samples each year. You can see during this video, we have a lot of equipment in our laboratory. There are a lot of maintenance agreements that we have with different vendors and manufacturers. It takes a lot for us to keep up and running every day of the year. Thank you so much for watching this video. And if you have any other questions about what we do at the Animal Disease Diagnostic Lab, just ask. Thank you.